feels good.
In July.
Today at the close of worship, you will be invited to come to the front to lay your commitment card on the altar. This is symbolic of our commitment to God's church here at Second Baptist and a way of dedicating it to the Lord. We're still accepting groceries for the food pantry. The food drive will end after Thanksgiving when the groceries are transported to the food pantry on November 28th, and they have been very grateful for what we've been able to share so far. Next Saturday morning at 9, we need a lot of help decorating the church for Christmas. Thanksgiving will be over, Black Friday will be over, Husker football will be over, so a number of us can work off some of that turkey by coming to help decorate, and I hope that you do. Whether you have signed up or not, we hope that you will plan to come to our Thanksgiving dinner this afternoon at 5. There will be plenty for everybody. We had our last Wednesday night Bible study until January. We always take December off because of busy schedules. And so we'll plan to start back the first Wednesday of January. And I believe Joyce has an announcement.
Last year about this time, the American Baptist Women have a mission project, and we made it more local. And a year ago, we started collecting underwear for the city mission. And we collected for men, women, and children. And I called and talked to one of the representatives there, and she said that all is welcome. She suggested two different things, one for men's sizes up to 4X, which is good. She says that sometimes they don't have even a pair of underwear to replace the one when they're washing, but they just took off. So I think we often think of the outerwear, but we forget about the innerwear. And then she said for socks, especially for men, if you could, warmer ones, but she says anything is welcome. So starting next Sunday, there will be a canister out here in the hallway, it's red stripe, and we'll begin collecting underwear again for the city mission. If you do not want to go shopping for it or don't want to have the time to, you can give me the cash, and when we've finished our campaign, then I'll go out and shop and finish up. So I would just, this in our lives at this time is really kind of rough because everybody needs something. And so just do what you can and God will bless that. Thank you.
Thank you, Joyce. This morning's scripture reading or invocation scripture comes from Psalm 105. Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him. Sing praise to him. Tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Will you pray with me? O Lord our God, where is there another God like you? A God of justice, an unfailing love who stands by every promise made to his people, generation after generation. There is no other. You alone are God. And so we gather together to worship you, to give you thanks, to proclaim your greatness, to sing your praise, to seek your face, and to celebrate your faithful presence with us. We pray that your Spirit would guide and inspire our worship. Open our mouths to sing and speak your praise. Open our ears to hear your word. Open our eyes eyes to see you at work among us. Open our hearts to receive your love. We offer ourselves to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
As we prepare to praise, and you can go ahead and stand, please note in your bulletin that the first hymn we sing will be verse 1. The second one will be verses 1, 3, and 5. And then the third hymn we sing when we gather together will be all three arrowed verses. So let's join together.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Looks like we got some folks traveling or sick or something. I know we've got a lot of people sick. This stuff's been going around, and so we're dealing with it. I wanted to mention that, as Grace talked about, that we're going to be bringing our commitments forward today. And so I want to ask our ushers if you have additional cards available so that we could have those distributed to anybody that doesn't have them. Are our ushers available back there? No? Yes? We like to do this. We want to make sure everybody has one. Besides that, I forgot mine in my office and I need one. Give Glenn a chance there. Raise your hand if you don't have a card. If you'd like one, raise your hand. Am I the only one? Oh, we've got others. Good. I'm not the only one.
You need one?
I do need one. And I'll take one from Maryland, too. For how many? Maryland. Now, this might be different for some of you, and so at the end of the service, we're going to be bringing these cards forward. If you choose to do this, if you don't, that's okay. But this is our way of trying to projecting what we our budget will be for this coming year. I want to take just a few minutes to anybody else? Okay. I want to take just a few minutes to instead today of, you know, we come every Sunday with our needs before God. And there are some current needs right now that I want to mention, but most of all today, I want you to, if you feel led, to raise your hand and just to say, this is what I'm thankful for. I want to give you that opportunity too. Along with our prayer requests, I want to give you an opportunity to just tell how God has blessed you in your life. It is Thanksgiving. We should be doing this year round, but nevertheless, we're going to give you that opportunity today. I want to mention that Julia mentioned to me this morning that her friend Ken Rausch passed away. He had pancreatic cancer and he passed away, and so we want to remember their family. And Julia mentioned to me how much that she appreciates our church family remembering Ken through his last days. I want to mention also that Zach Lewis, we mentioned him last week, was part in a car accident, a very serious car accident. I think it was in the news. He was at a stoplight, and a person was driving anywhere from 70 to 100 miles per hour and slammed into him. And he has been in an induced coma. They're going to gradually try to bring him out of that. But he's making some improvements. They've done some surgeries on ribs and different various things. But we need to pray for Zach Lewis and pray for his healing. We don't know what the outcome is going to be yet. They were concerned about swelling, brain swelling and everything last week. But let's remember him in prayer. Let's go before the Lord in a time of quietness and prayer. Struggling with various illnesses, we lift them up to you. God, we want to thank you, Lord, today for the many answers to prayer as well. We are so grateful, Lord, for how you have brought healing into the lives of people. And Lord God, today as we share in this time of gratitude, we pray for our nation. We pray for our politicians. We pray for our leaders. We pray for our school teachers. For our friends and our neighbors. The people who serve our community, our police officers and our first responders. Father, we thank you for each of them. And now, Lord, we pray today the way that you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
join together in hymn number 563, Count Your Blessings.
Thank you.
Father, we are thankful. We are thankful for the many gifts that you endow to each one of us. But Lord, most of all, we're thankful for the Lord Jesus Christ, who went to the cross that we can have life. And Father, today as we give, may these gifts be out of our love for you. And Father, may these gifts be used to bring honor to your name. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Today's scripture is Psalms 95, verses 1 through 7. It's on page 691 of the Bible, if you want to turn to it, and it's up on the screen. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King, above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are his pasture, the flock under his care. Amen.
I'm guessing those words, that last verse probably sounds familiar to you because we sing a chorus that has those words, come let us worship and bow down. I just have to pause for just a second to just say that we are in the presence of a God who has been so gracious to this congregation over this past year in so many ways. And if Nalene and Kay's music this morning wasn't a reminder of that, I don't know what is. Because a few months ago when Michael resigned, you know, we just were kind of like, what do we do? And God has stepped in. I didn't know that at that time that Nalene had played organ in a church down in Texas. I didn't know at that time that Mark Pudwell would even consider coming back and serving up here in Lincoln. And everything just fell into place in God's providence. And I didn't do anything except just wait and pray.
Amen.
You didn't do anything except wait and pray. And for the new people in our congregation this year, I'm grateful to the Lord for that. We're reminded in so many ways. Never in my ministry have I felt more blessed than I do right now. I was up at our region board meeting this last week, and that came up in the little group that I was in. I shared with that little group about what God has been doing, because we were asked to do that, what God has been doing in our life. And, you know, sometimes pastors get down. Sometimes we get maybe not down is the word, although we do get down, but more like complacent, more like everything, nothing changes. Everything is just blah, everything, you know, the day-to-day, nothing changes. And we don't see the hand of God at work. And maybe it's because we're not looking for the hand of God to be at work. But it couldn't escape me this year in any way, shape, or form. It was so clear of how God has intervened in so many ways and just stepped in and done what God wants to do. And so I just had to share that just as an aside to what I'm going to share today. I always enjoy preaching on Thanksgiving because, you know, there's just nothing that is more amazing than the hand of God at work in our lives. They say that everybody gets a little bit more friendly around Thanksgiving time. That's what they say. I don't know. Everyone lightens up just a little bit, cuts each other a little bit more slack than normal. We don't mind the long lines at the grocery store quite as much because, and maybe there's a few more smiles on the faces of those who are in line at the grocery store. We're a little bit more gracious in traffic, I hope. We also have a tendency to link Thanksgiving and Christmas together, don't we? It's kind of become part of our pattern, our routine, is that, you know, Thanksgiving, before the turkey on the platter is even cold, we're already getting ready, putting our coats on to rush out and to do our Black Friday shopping or even our Thanksgiving Day shopping. The morning after Thanksgiving, the big sales are going on. In fact, I would bet that sometime in the evening on Thanksgiving Day that you'll even drive around town and look at some of the Christmas lights. One of our traditions back when I was in seminary was to go down to the, in Kansas City, to go down to the plaza. And as they hit that big switch, they have some celebrity step up and hit that switch and all the lights on all of the plaza come on. And it's beautiful. But you know what, we have this little tiny window of gratitude. The first Thanksgiving in 1621 was born in Paradox. About half of the 102 people who traveled from England to America died before summertime. And so there's only about 50 left when it came time to have that Thanksgiving feast that we celebrate. About 50 pilgrims and about 90 Native Americans chose to give thanks at that feast. This week, we will choose to give thanks to God as well. And we thank Him for another year. We thank God for, in the midst of the political turmoil that we've seen and the international crisis that we've seen, the big economic downturn that we've all experienced. Others have a lingering memory of lives lost this past year. But in the midst of it all, we will choose to be thankful. Some will choose to be thankful in the midst of a deadly health problem that you might be facing. Others will offer thanks even though family is not close and your health is being weakened, that you can still find a place in your heart to give thanks to God. Choosing to give thanks to God is a conscious choice that we all have to make. I learned early on in life that you should always find something to be grateful for in every situation that you find yourself in. Not always that way. Sometimes I'm just kind of bowled over by all the problem itself. But most of the time, and especially in hindsight, we can look and we can see, you know what? God was there all along. Amen. And the Lord has blessed us, even in the midst of the trials and the tragedies of life. It's those times that God teaches and He molds us and God forms our hearts and shapes us to be the kind of people that He wants us to be. Isaac Newton, remember him? The apple and so on. He said that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. That happens not only in the area of physics, but also in the area of life in general. What will be your reaction to Thanksgiving this year after what has occurred in your life this past year? What will be your reaction to God's provision in your life? Will we take it for granted or will we give praise? We're kind of used to a cause and effect in life, aren't we? We understand it. It's measurable. And a lot of times we play cause and effect with God. God, if you do something for me, I will do something for you. If you will bless me in this, God, I will serve you forever. I remember watching a movie back in the 70s. I can't remember what the name of the movie was, but Burt Reynolds was in it. And he was off the coast. He had fallen out of a boat. I don't even remember what happened, but he was about a half mile out. And he says, God, if you'll rescue me, God, I will give 90% of everything that I own. I'll give it to you. And then he starts swimming to shore, and he gets about, you know, 50 yards, and he says, God, if you rescue me from this, I'll give you 80% of everything that I own. And he swims some more, and God, I'll give you 70% of everything that I have. And that reminds me so much of us, that the more secure we feel in our own life, in our own abilities, in our own accomplishments, the less grateful we oftentimes are. The less we realize that God is the one who is at work in our lives. Dave Stone, a former pastor from Louisville, Kentucky, tells a story about going into a Pizza Hut, and the waitress comes by to take their order, and after the waitress took the order, she pulled out a little egg timer, and she set it. And she said, this is a new promotion that we're having. We set these timers for 15 minutes, and if the timer stops before you get your pizza, the next pizza is free. And so Pastor Dave said, okay, and the other three guys he was with started talking together, but Dave just couldn't stop staring at that egg timer. It got down to about a minute. And Pastor Dave waved at the waitress. 1 minute to go. It goes like this. And he could see her putting drinks on the tables of other customers and so on. And the timer got down to 20 seconds. And he realized that she wasn't going to make it. The timer went off. About 10 seconds after the timer went off, the waitress came with the pizza. And Dave said, it looks like you were a little late there. And she said, I guess so. And so she went back and she brought back 4 vouchers for free pizzas and handed them out to each person at the table. Now here's the question. Are you ever guilty of treating the God of the universe a little bit like a Pizza Hut waitress? God is clear in his text that he is in charge. That God is in control of all things that we experience. Verse 3 says, he is the great king above all gods. And this verse is in effect saying that God is not here to jump through our hoops, to bring our pizza, and to do it on time. That's not a godly cause and effect. That's not really how it works, because God is in control. We don't place demands on the king of the universe. But I can tell you one thing, the king of the universe is gracious to us in every way. And we should offer our gratitude to God. Listen again to verses 1 through 3 that Gary read today. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is a great God, the great King above all gods. The resounding message of this verse is the God who saves us is worthy of our praise. That's it. We belong to him. And that's great news to us. But this verse just reaffirms that true Christianity, true faith, is not defined in who you are, but it's more accurately found in who you belong to and who God is. We are the work of God. He created us. He says to Jeremiah, right in the beginning of Jeremiah, the first chapter, one of my favorite little verses, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. God knew us before we were even born. God created you. He gave you your personality. as weird as that might be. And what's more, he set you apart as well. The word holy means to be set apart. He has made us holy, to be set apart for his purpose. That's what that means. In the case of Jeremiah, he was set apart to be a prophet. I really believe that God forms us to be people who offer the world something. That each of us have something to offer to the world around us. How refreshing to know that God has a special purpose for each of us. He's given each of us spiritual gifts to exercise for his glory. There's a praise chorus that I love. I'm not going to sing it. But these are the words to it. It's called He Knows My Name. And it says, I have a maker. He formed my heart. Before even time began, my life was in his hands. The second verse says, I have a father. He calls me his own. He'll never leave me, no matter where I go. And then the chorus is, he knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls, and he hears me when I call. We have a personal God. Not a God who just made us and left us, abandoned us, but a God who loves us and who knows every aspect of our lives. That's why we worship. That's why we come here. That's why we're joyful. That's why we show our thanksgiving. Because even if nothing else is going right in our lives, we know that we have a Father who calls us his own. This is a mandate of thankfulness here. Not a suggestion, but rather a mandate to be thankful. Psalm 96, the following chapter, says, I sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord. Praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day. That's a command. There's no you should do this in front of me. It says, you do this. God wants joyful worshipers, people who are committed to expressing themselves to him in worship. You know, worship should never feel contrived or stuffy. We should come singing, and we should come with joyfulness as we come here. Sometimes you walk into a church, and it's like this funeral that's been going on for 2,000 years. That's what Christianity is. And it's not. It's not a funeral. It's a resurrection of Jesus from the tomb. I know that my Jesus broke out of that tomb. That he rescued me from a life of meaningless mediocrity. And so my worship should not be meaningless mediocrity. It should be joyful. The God I serve resurrected Jesus from the dead. And gave me the promise that God has conquered death. It's a time to show our thanks. Psalm 95, 4 through 7, the last verses that Gary read today. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. This is the place to show gratitude to God. We have a tendency to look at all the negative things that happen in life, but that kind of lifestyle is completely contrary to what Scripture teaches. We need to accurately display Christ-like attitudes and Christ-like joyfulness and grace and compassion as we live. Listen to what the book of Colossians says in chapter 3. He says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. And as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. My hope and my desire for each of us is that we will live out the practice of gratitude as we live our lives, to have joyful, joyous, and grateful thanksgiving wherever you are, whatever you will be doing this week. May Jesus Christ be at the center of that, and may you have thankfulness. I want to change gears for just a minute. It's no accident that we have our annual commitment drive on the same Sunday that we celebrate Thanksgiving, because there's a connection between gratitude and generosity. We do it because generosity and gratitude are linked throughout Scripture. You will hear me call this Commitment Sunday. You will hear other people call it Pledge Sunday. I don't care what you call it. I don't like pledge because I think of compulsion. And the Bible says that we should be cheerful givers, not giving under compulsion, but that we should be giving joyfully. And we're making a commitment to the Lord. Something that we're doing out of our love and gratitude, not being guilted into doing it. I hope that you'll give generously today. So we're going to, as we sing our last song today, we're going to be coming down the aisle just randomly, whoever wants to, just bring it down, and you're going to lay it right here at the front. And then we'll sing our closing song as we normally do. So let's stand together. Take your hymnal and turn to 556. It's a time of expressing our gratitude, and I hope that you'll come tonight and be part of that dinner together. As you go from here today, may the Lord walk with you. May the Lord give you a thankful heart as you celebrate this week with family and friends. May you make the Lord Jesus Christ the center of that table as you come together. Go in God's peace. Amen. Let's sing our closing song together.